Good morning. My name is Pastor Brian White, and I want to welcome you to this Sunday morning traditional worship here at St. Mark's United Methodist Church in Carmel. We're glad that you are joining us online. Take a few moments to make a comment if you're on Facebook and let us know you're there and kind of interact this morning as we worship on this Lord's Day. We're going to begin worship this morning with a call to worship. So I will be the leader, and we're welcoming Dean Selesky as our liturgist today, and so he will lead the people part. So if you're at home, you can speak along with Dean as we read responsibly. The one who calls you together this day yearns for each of you and for all people to hear and be blessed.
Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening.
Blessed is the one who comes bringing trustworthy words for the healing of the world.
Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening.
Let us join in our hymn, Christ for the World We Sing.
Help us to listen to your urgings with prayerful hearts so that we may honor what you have made. In the name of the Holy Trinity, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Dean. I'm Pastor Julia Gonzalez, and I have a few announcements for you this morning. For starters, a reminder that Kids Connect Live happens on Zoom every Sunday at 10 a.m. And we also have Club 56 Live happening on Zoom this afternoon from 1 to 2 p.m. If you are interested in or of age to take part in either of those groups, please reach out to Ramey Cooney, that's R-C-O-O-N-E-Y, at stmarkscarmel.org. As a reminder, today is Human Relations Day. This Sunday is one of our United Methodist special Sundays. Human Relations Day is when we will take a special offering to help strengthen United Methodist outreach to communities in the United States and Puerto Rico, encouraging social justice and work with at-risk youth. If you would like to donate for this special Sunday, you can go online at stmarkscarmel.org/give. I'd also like to remind you that we are in the midst of 100 days of prayer, and it is not too late to take part. It is never too late to start praying, especially to take part in prayers for our nation as we look ahead to a historic week, and we seek always for God's will to be done. We have several new studies that have been starting up, and we also have a spiritual weekend walk alumni gathering. And if you've ever taken part in a walk to Emmaus, Chrysalis Flight, Great Banquet, Cursillo, Tres Dias, or similar intensive spiritual weekend, you can join for a Zoom social gathering of St. Mark's folks who have attended these events to meet one another and share memories. This will be on January 31st from 6:30 to 7:30. And Jennifer Cloud Buckner and Marianne Moman will be leading these meetings. And you can learn more by going to stmarkscarmel.org/walkalumni. We are also looking to see if there is anyone interested in taking part in a weeknight evening adult discipleship study. If you are interested in taking part of this group, we have a few people who are, but we still need more people. Please go to stmarkscarmel.org/studygroups or reach out to Jennifer Cloud Buckner, our adult discipleship coordinator. We have several opportunities for service with Soups On to Go at Roberts Park. St. Mark's will be providing the meals to go for January 31st. Please help us offer lunch for those less fortunate by choosing from the list of food items needed. You can find those items at stmarkscarmel.org/signups. That's one word. And food donations will be accepted through Monday, January 25th. If you have any questions, please contact Tricia Stainert for more information, or you can reach out to Stephanie Cohen, who can help you get in touch with Tricia. Our mission focus for January is Mission Guatemala. Mission Guatemala is a United Methodist-related organization with a mission to help meet the basic needs and improve the quality of life of underserved Guatemalan people. Guatemala has one of the highest rates in the world for chronic childhood malnutrition, and we have been able to do a lot of good in partnership with Mission Guatemala, and we are seeking to continue to do that good work into the future. If you would like to help, you may make a financial donation to Mission Guatemala by going online to stmarkscarmel.org/give. And remember that even though we are meeting virtually, we are still doing the work of the church through our mission projects, through the work that we are seeing happen around the church, our outreach, and to help make that possible, your tithes make a huge difference. And you can tithe at stmarkscarmel.org/give. We have a text to give option, and we still have the option of sending checks into the church office. Although speaking of the church office, we've been having the office open on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings, but with Martin Luther King Jr. Day tomorrow, the office will be closed. Finally, please remember to register your attendance this morning by visiting our website, stmarkscarmel.org/attend. And remember that this is a great way to let us know that you're here, and also to let us know if there are any prayer requests that you have for the pastors or for our prayer chain. These are our announcements for this morning. I invite you now to join me in a time of prayer. Let us go to God. Creator God, we open ourselves to the movement of the Spirit, knowing that you know us well, that you formed us even while we were yet in our mother's womb. You created us with love and patient care, creating living works of art in each of us, a part of your beautiful creation. Yet how often, God, do we mistreat one another? How often do many of us reject the people that you love? How often do we find ourselves feeling rejected by others, not for anything we have done, but because of the color of our skin, the amount of money that we earn, the ability of our hands, eyes, mouths, and ears. How often do we trust in the brokenness of the world rather than trust in the perfection that is your love? Lord, we need your healing. We ask for it knowing that by asking we shall receive. Set us free that we may love and know one another fully as pieces of your creation that are each unique and yet equal in the love that you have for us. As we face the challenges of this week, as we face the challenges of our past, set our hearts to love one another, to love ourselves, to love our enemies, and to love you, even when it is hard. And Almighty God, when words seem to fail, when we find ourselves not knowing what to do or what to say, let us fall back on the words that we may say and pray with the saints who have gone before us and who will come after us, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, speaking together in heart and voice, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Natalie and Liz. Today's gospel lesson comes from John chapter 1, verses 43 to 51. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." And Nathanael said, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the word of God for the people of God.
I have to say, as I was thinking of this sermon title this weekend, I will tell you, after 35 years of preaching 50 some odd weeks a year, sermon titles are not my favorite thing to try to come up with. But I was looking at this particular passage and thinking about Jesus calling the disciples, and particularly calling Philip and Nathanael. I thought about our own lives and how oftentimes we get phone calls. It used to be when you got a phone call that you didn't know who it was until you picked up the phone. And you answered the phone, and then you found out who was calling. And sometimes when you answered the phone, you'd say, "Oh boy, you talked to," and sometimes you'd say, "Oh, I wish I hadn't picked up that phone call." But in more recent times, and I suspect for some of you who are listening today, you probably don't remember the times before caller ID. And today, generally, when we get a phone call, we look to see who's calling. And then we make a decision about answering that call or not answering that call, letting to get to go to voicemail, or just ignoring it in general, as a lot of times those phone calls are spam phone calls or people trying to sell us something. And so I thought about that in the context of today's scripture lesson, and I divided this into two parts. The first one is, it's God's calling, it's God calling, and it's for you, or it's for me. A lot of times, how we respond to a call has to do with who is doing the calling. Now, in Jesus' day, and in this, as the Gospels begin to unfold, almost all of Jesus' early disciples were, in fact, originally disciples of John the Baptist. And this story kind of follows soon after Jesus' own baptism. And there begins this brief period of time in which there is this transition from John the Baptist to Jesus. As a matter of fact, John the Baptist kind of foreshadowed that when he said, "I am not worthy to unloose the sandals, but of the person who comes after me, who will baptize you with spirit and with fire." And so John was well positioned to then lead people from being disciples of himself to then being disciples of Jesus. And so Jesus begins to make disciples, and there is a point at which John points to Jesus and said, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." Now, Lamb of God was an image that people would have been well aware of in the first century Jewish community. And so Jesus kind of begins to fill this prophetic role of being the Lamb, that which takes away people's sins. So we come to this particular moment today where Jesus is calling two disciples. And the first one seems very straightforward. In the beginning, it says Jesus decided to go to Galilee. Jesus probably had been closer to Jerusalem before that, and he decides to go up to Galilee, which is north of Jerusalem, even today, probably 2 or 3 hours by bus. When you're going from Jerusalem to Galilee, you have to make a choice about how you travel. If you wanted to go and stay basically in land that was controlled and occupied primarily by Israel, or at least friendly to Israel, you would have to make a roundabout circuitous route to get from Jerusalem to Galilee. To go directly north meant that you went through Samaria. Now today, that a very similar situation is true, because if you are in Israel, if you want to go from Jerusalem to Galilee, you have to go in a sort of an arc to avoid the occupied West Bank. Otherwise, you have to travel through the occupied West Bank, which used to be Samaria. So these 2,000-year-old social realities are still true today. And so Jesus went from closer southern Israel to Galilee, and Galilee was kind of the rural fringe. In today's parlance, we would think of Galilee as sort of a flyover state. It was the place that was more rural, and people in Jerusalem didn't really see Galilee as having any profound impact on their lives or thought. So Jesus goes to Galilee, he finds Philip, and he says, "Follow me." And that's all there is to that story. Philip follows him, and as a matter of fact, Philip then goes to find Nathanael. And he says to Nathanael, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Now Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip says, "Come and see." This has been one of those pattern moments in people's lives when we are reminded that as we are called to be God's people, we are then called to share that good news with other folks. And Philip gives us this pattern for then witnessing to what God has done in his life to Nathanael. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him from a ways off. And he said to those who were with him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Now, Nathanael then asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" And this is one of those realities that as God calls people, God sees into their lives. And as Jesus meets people, he often sees deeply into their lives. For instance, when Jesus met the woman at the well, a story a little later in John's gospel, he has this dialogue with the woman at the well, and then she is changed by that dialogue, and she goes to her friends and brings them to Jesus. And the thing that she says to them is, "Come see this person who knows all there is to know about me, who has seen into my very life and being." Now, for many of us, having someone who knew everything or knows everything about us could be a little frightening. We joke around about it. I was in a meeting this week where there were several people at the meeting that I had gone on trips with, and I said, "You know, these people probably know more about me than I want shared, you know, in this context." And one of them replied and said, "Yes, but you know more about us as well." So that kind of holds things in check. We have different names in different contexts. And Jesus and God throughout the Bible often names people and changes their names as a symbol of the changes in their lives. My name is Brian. Most people know that. I have at times been known as Mr. White. I have also been known as Reverend White in the last decade or so as Dr. White. I've been known as Michelle's husband. I've been known as Audra and Ian's dad, or now even as Grandpa. Throughout my life, the names that I've been called have been indicative of the roles that have changed, and I suspect many of us have experienced that as well. Have you ever been in the awkward situation where you really should introduce someone to someone else, but you can't remember their name? You know, you're standing there and you're waiting and you're hoping that that person will introduce themselves to whoever you're with and relieve the awkwardness of the moment. I don't think Jesus ever had that awkward moment. Jesus knew the people that he was with. He had insight into their lives and into their being. And as he named things in their lives, they often were changed by that. One of the most powerful moments, I think, in the Gospel of John is right after Jesus is resurrected and he's in the garden and where the tomb is. And Mary comes to prepare his body, and the tomb is empty, and she's confused, and Jesus is there, and she at first thinks he is a gardener, and she asks him where the body of Jesus has gone, and Jesus replies to her with this. He says, Mary. He says her name, and in that moment, she recognizes who he is. There are powerful things about being named. There are powerful things about people who know us and know things about our nature and who we are and can name those things in meaningful and deep ways. When Jesus said people's name, it was more than just saying their name. It was saying, I know who you are. I know your identity and I know who you can be. When Paul meets the spirit of Jesus on the road to Damascus, and eventually his name is changed to reflect that moment, there is a power in God naming Paul and saying, Paul, why, Saul, his name is Saul at that point, saying, Saul, why do you persecute me? Naming not only who he is, but his character in that moment. And so I think about what does it mean for God to call us? What does it mean for us to hear this voice of someone who names us, not only who we are, but names us in a new way and says, this is who you can be. This is who I want you to be. This is who I am calling you to be. There is a time in Matthew's gospel where Jesus has a conversation with the disciples and sort of introduces the reverse of this idea. He has named them as his disciples, but now he asks them, who am I to you? When Jesus came to the area of Caesarea Philippi, it says, he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? And some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he says, what about you? Who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And so there is this mutuality in which Jesus names us, and we in turn name Jesus in our relationship with us. And we begin then to proclaim that relationship to others. In the past year, I have read more in the last year than I have any other year, and I'm probably not unique in that reality. And I often record my reading on an app called Goodreads. I know a lot of people probably use Goodreads. And one of the things that I always find interesting is each morning I get an email from Goodreads giving people's, my friends, a few of my friends, updates. And I'm always interested to see what other people are reading. And there are certain people on my Goodreads list, and I'm not going to tell you who these are, that if they give someone a book a good review, I know probably I'm not going to want to read that book because we just have different tastes in reading and literature. Now, there are other people on my Goodreads list who, if they give a good review for a book, I mark that down and I say, I need to add that to my to-read list. But either way, I know if I have read something and I'm really thrilled about it, I write a review. I put it on my Facebook page. I don't put all my reviews on Facebook page. But I want to let people know that this has impacted my life. In a lot of ways, when we encounter Jesus Christ, it ought to be like that. I was attending two Sunday school classes this morning by Zoom. I don't attend Sunday school every week, but I didn't attend the current this morning, but I attended two Sunday school classes. And one of the universal experiences in my Sunday school classes as people are chatting at the beginning is that they begin to share their excitement about their sports teams. And who has won this week, who has lost this week. And I have never been in one of those groups or classes where I had to beg someone to share about a victory their sports team has had in the last week. People just do that naturally and spontaneously because they are excited about sharing that good news. Sharing about Jesus Christ should be like that. It should be something that we do spontaneously, naturally, and it should be something that comes out of our excitement in having been named and claimed by Jesus Christ. By the end of this story, Philip and Nathanael are our disciples. They're following Jesus. And part of their role for the next few years will be to tell the good news about what Jesus has done in their lives. And so when we get a call from God, when it's God calling, it's for you. God doesn't just call us into relationship. God calls us into relationship for a purpose. God calls us by name so that our name can be changed, not just that we now have our name Brian, but we are Brian who is a Christian, who is a follower of Jesus Christ, who has now been named as a child of God. And as we are named by God, we then go and proclaim the good news of what God has done in our lives. Jesus recruits these disciples, and I believe Jesus continues to recruit disciples in our lives and in our world. But he does that for a purpose, so that we can be agents of God's good news, so that we can proclaim the love and grace of Christ in our lives, and we can speak those words of love and grace in other people's lives. So we can do the things that Jesus calls us to do in Matthew 25, to clothe the naked, to provide homes for the homeless, to visit those who are sick and in prison, to be the hands and feet of God in our world. And so today I am reminded, and I want to remind you, that God continues to call us, and we have a choice. Will we answer that call, and will we say yes to the things to which God calls us to be and to do as disciples of Jesus Christ? Let us pray. Almighty and holy God, it is tempting sometimes to say no to the call that you place upon our lives, because we know it. Sometimes the road to which you call us might be a hard road to walk. But we pray, O God, that we may say yes to your call upon our lives. As you name us and as you speak your grace and love into our lives, help us to be your messengers to speak those words of love and grace into other people's lives, to be your servants. And to say when you call, here I am, Lord, send me. Amen.
By the Lord of sea and sky. I have heard my people's cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go. Of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I am. Tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go.
May you go in the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. May you know that you are named in God's heart. May you go to share that good news with others in the power of God's Spirit. Amen. Thank you.